Hey, Pastor Steve Waldron here. You know, one fascinating thing is you read through Scripture, you learn so much. And, you know, Paul, he never rebuked the Jews because they didn't believe in a Trinity. Now, we're told today in so many circles that unless you believe in the doctrine of the Trinity, you can't be saved. And I'm like, well, you know, the word's not mentioned in Scripture. The concept's not mentioned in Scripture. It comes from Neoplatonism. And who was it? Photinus or whoever was the founder of the Neoplatonic school near Clement of Alexandria. I can't remember right now. But anyhow, it's like, so you'd think if this is something that's essential to salvation, Paul would have taken the Jews and said, hey guys, we were wrong. God is a Trinity. He's not monotheistic like we said. He's not God is a spirit, but God is a Trinity. And so, but when you see the interaction between Paul and the Jews, and you can see it in the book of Acts, but then also in all his epistles, and I do believe that Paul penned Hebrews, but you can have a different opinion of that, so 14 epistles as well. You see his interaction has nothing to do with the Jews being wrong on the concept of God. I mean, basically he says, look, you guys were right, I was right on the concept of God. It's on the person of Jesus Christ. Is he the Messiah? And then if he's the Messiah, he's God in flesh. Isaiah 9:6, Isaiah 7:14, Isaiah 40 verses 7 and 8, that our God will come and save us. You know, Isaiah 35, that God, when he comes to save us, the deaf will hear and the dumb will speak and the lame man will leap as an hart in all of this. So they knew that the Jewish Messiah was supposed to be God in flesh. They knew this, and that's the reason they militated so badly against this. And Jesus keeps going around saying, you know, and that's what the term Son of God means, is he's God in flesh. He's both God and man. And so the Jesus is going around saying, when you've seen me, you've seen the Father. John is writing about Jesus when Isaiah saw God high and lifted up in Isaiah chapter 6. He said, well, that was Jesus. Jesus said, before Abraham was, I am. He's claiming to be the great I am. The Aher Yasha Shia, I can't remember how to say it right now in Hebrew. But he claimed to be the great I Am of Exodus 3:14. And so, you know, Genesis 22:8, you know, Abraham talking to Isaac, God will provide himself a lamb. God, he's going to be both God and man. He's going to be both high priest and sacrifice. And so Paul never had these discussions. So people say, well, the Trinity was a doctrine that was developed. Well, I thought you believed in sola scriptura. So I thought it was all about what's found in Scripture. So if something is developed and the church, and when people say the church, all they mean by that is that they took over the see of Peter, or the seat of Peter, in 222 AD, and that whosoever he puts in heaven, they misinterpret Matthew 16, that Peter is the rock. Whatsoever he binds on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatsoever he looses on earth will be loosed in heaven. And they basically say that the See of Peter can make doctrine regardless of Scripture. And this is where you get into the perpetual virginity of Mary, or the Immaculate Conception of Mary, and that Mary's progeny must have been, if Mary didn't have original sin, then her family must not have original sin, and the purgatory, and the praying to saints. And so, you have this. So they do give some validity to Scripture, but then they can say that their church tradition, ecumenical councils, when the Pope speaks ex cathedra, can actually transcend Scripture or interpret Scripture in an infallible way, that the way it's not meant to be interpreted. And so, again, Paul never, ever rebuked the Jews for not believing in the Trinity. He just said, you don't believe your Messiah has come. And so this is the discussion. I've turned here to Acts 28:23, it says, and when they had appointed him a day, this is the Jews in Rome where Paul is in prison, there came many to him into his lodging, to whom he expounded and testified the kingdom of God, persuading them concerning Jesus, both out of the law of Moses and out of the prophets, from morning till evening. But this is representative of how he dealt with the Jews. Verse 1 of Romans chapter 3. What advantage then hath the Jew, or what profit is there of circumcision? Much every way, chiefly that unto them were committed the oracles of God. He doesn't say, well, Abraham didn't believe in the Trinity, so he was in darkness. Moses didn't. David didn't. Malachi didn't. Isaiah didn't. And so if God would have wanted to communicate that he was a Trinity, he could have put the word or triune or triunity somewhere in Scripture. He could have had this word or some of the ancillary comments. So I just want you to think about that in theology. I believe in the deity of Jesus Christ. I believe God is our Father. I believe in the power of the Holy Ghost, that is God's Spirit coming out from him. But to say there's three persons, and see, even that gets so sketchy, because they say there's three persons, and I'm like, well, isn't that tritheism? Oh, we don't mean persons like you and me. We mean persons in a theological sense. And I'm like, but isn't that, most people don't study theology, so isn't that disingenuous to teach to the masses? Yeah, and so much of the Trinity is like that. And it leads to either tritheism, subordinationism, or then they just say it's the mystery. And so I think it's just better to try as we can to use biblical language. But I'm not throwing shade, casting aspersion on anybody that is a Trinitarian. I'm just wanting us to think and to through the power of the Holy Ghost and the love of God, because obviously he wants to reveal himself. He gave us scripture to do that, and a heart, a conscience, you know, Romans 1 to do that. To understand who Jesus is. And so Paul, you know, Peter, they're not getting in debates about the Trinity in the early church. And so if we want to be a New Testament church, which I think we all would, and even though some people get into the liturgy and the representations of the liturgy, and I get it. I can understand all that. I can understand the awe people have of the Mass. I understand that. And but we've got to be New Testament. We can't do anything. We can't just because something is so amazing that it diverts us from the Scripture. Because we're not going to be judged by those things. We're going to be judged by the Word of God. And so we need to get back to the Word of God. So God bless. Love you in Jesus' name. Talk with you later.